Hi friends, is my voice is audible to you? If my voice is audible and if everything is fine, please let me know. If you are in online, please say hi so that I will know. Hi, Sai, how are you? Hope you are fine, right? Is my voice is audible to you? Right? Okay. Let me check one second. Yeah. Just want to know how many of you people are in online. Hi Vasant Sai. So let me start the session, bros. Today the session is all about marathon on plagued beams using limit state of in limit state of flexure. We are going to design for flexure. Plagued beams like T beams or L beams. Okay, right. Before I start the session, I just want to say a big hi to all of my brothers and sisters who are on the online, right? And I just want to convey one more thing, like so much of free content is already happening in this Unacademy learning gap. If you're a serious aspirant of GATE or ESE or any other competitive examination, I can recommend you to download this Unacademy learning gap so that you can watch the extra free content which is happening there. And even you can have the paid course directly, you can have access to the paid course in the Unacademy learning app also. So even for that also, I can recommend you to install the Unacademy learning app. After you install the Unacademy learning app from Play Store, if you are able to use this link which is given here, and if you type this link directly in the app, so directly you are able to follow me. When you are able to follow me, there are three advantages are there. First and foremost advantage is already free content done by me in Unacademy learning app you are able to access. The upcoming free video lectures, free courses will be notified to you. Third thing, at the end of each and every session, we will provide free PDFs, notes regarding that particular topic. So you can have access for that one also. These are the advantages when you follow me, right? Okay. Some people will say like, sir, before I start this session, I just want to say there are some paid courses are also happening in Unacademy learning app, especially in Plus, in Unacademy Plus platform. So many free paid courses are there. If you want to purchase the paid course, select this goal as GATE and ESE, and you can get the subscription or you can take the paid course by moving to in the main menu by moving to Unacademy Plus courses. Unacademy Plus courses in the drop down menu, you can go to subscription, get subscription. By clicking this get subscription in Unacademy Plus, you are able to, the page will redirect to the payment and you can pay and you can come down to the paid course, right? And after you get this plus subscription, okay, you will get unlimited access to live and recorded courses from the India's topmost faculty, right? And there is no need to go to Bombay, there is no need to go to Delhi. All the topmost faculty of India are right now available at your doorstep through Unacademy. The doors and windows of Unacademy are directly open when you take the subscription using with the help of single code VT10. When you use this code VT10, directly 10% discount will come on all the courses in Unacademy learning app or in Unacademy Plus platform especially, right? Okay, so some people will say like, sir, this is our first class, please introduce yourself. I am Venkat Tilak Koppalapati. People call me as Venkata sir. Some people call me as Tilak sir. I completed my master's degree from University of Sheffield, England, and about to complete my doctoral degree, which is PhD. My background of education is completed into structural engineering, brothers. So here also in an academy, I am going to tackle only structural engineering subjects ranging from engineering mechanics, strength of materials, structural analysis, concrete structures, steel structures, and finally to construction materials and management. These six subjects I will tackle, right? Some people will say like, sir, what is the specialty about this university from where you had graduated? This university is far better than IITs and IIC Bengaluru in terms of global rankings. Moreover, this university produced 6 Nobel Prize winners. So producing 6 Nobel Prize winners from a university is not a joke. You can understand the depth of research potentiality involved in that particular university. Okay. Some people will also ask us, sir, in addition to teaching, what is your previous experience? Previously, I worked as research scientist or research engineer, and I worked as a team lead also in University of South Carolina for a funded project. This is in USA. And previously, I worked as a head of the Department of Civil Engineering in an engineering college in Andhra Pradesh. So both I have local experience within India and a global experience, which is outside India also, right? So coming to my teaching experience, totally I have 12 years of teaching experience in teaching GATE and ESC in different coaching institutes all across India. So in addition to this one, I mentored lakhs of students, and moreover, being an independent structural design consultant, even till today, I am working as a structural design consultant, and I produce and I give the material testing reports to my clients, and I produce structural drawings to my clients. These are the brief background about me, right? Some people will say, like, sir, you asked us to install the Unacademy learning app, na? Sir, how to do that one, sir? So to say about that one, go to Play Store and type this name, Unacademy learning app. When you type this name, Unacademy learning app, you are able to see a championship type of trophy in this way, and you are able to install the learning app. After you install this learning app, you are able to see a video which is on the right hand side. You are able to see, this is the drop down menu. So there are two things to follow me. First of all, what you can do is, so in this main menu, go to free courses. If you want to follow me, go to free courses. After you go to free courses, in this search button, you type my name, Venkata Tilak Uppalapati. When you type my name, Venkata Tilak Uppalapati, right? All the, my profile will be visible to you. When my profile is visible to you, you just follow me. When you follow me, I hope I already teach you the advantage that you already know. So already free content done by me, you are able to access, and upcoming free lectures by me will be notified to you. Okay. Some people say, like, sir, there is a paid course is also available. You mentioned, na? So how I can get the paid course, right? So coming to how you can get the paid course in Unacademy Plus platform. So go to, first of all, you can install this Unacademy learning app. You can set this goal as GATE and ESC. Set this is the goal what you want to achieve. Maybe the PSU examinations, or maybe the GATE and ESC what you want to crack. You can keep that GATE and ESC. And in this main drop-down menu, keep or go to Plus Courses. Plus Courses means paid courses. After you move to paid courses, there is a thing called, there is a tab or button will be there called as Get Subscription. After you press this Get Subscription, it will redirect you to the payment page, and you can pay either by credit card or debit card, and or else you can pay by monthly installments also, using it with the help of credit card or debit card. So you can pay payment you do, right? This is how you can this is how you can access I can say paid codes. Some people will say, sir, what I will get if I had taken the Plus codes or Get Subscription or paid codes? Plus codes or Get Subscription in paid codes. What are the advantages? How it is advantages and compared to a non-paid user? So the first and foremost advantage, in order to crack any sort of competitive examination, instant doubt resolution should be there. That we are providing instant doubt resolution is possible in Unacademy learning app. By the time of daily live classes, you can talk directly with the educator, and the educator will resolve all your doubts instantly through polls. So that is the first and foremost advantage. In order to crack any sort of competitive exam, other competitive examination, I can say, like, in addition to daily live classes, okay, support of test series should also be there. So we are providing test series support in the form of live tests, quizzes, mock tests, daily wise tests, grand tests, whatever that may be. So after you write those test series exams, you can evaluate your performance. After you evaluate your performance, you can understand at what level you people guys are when compared to the topmost students of an academy. And if you are interested to increase your performance in some of the lagging areas, you can listen to more number of lectures in that particular topic, and by working on more number of problems and by working on more number subject wise tests in that particular topic. So that is how you can improve your performance. That is the second thing. So coming to the third thing, so there is no need to plan yourself. Each and every plan we will provide. So if you stick down to the plan, and within that plan, if you are able to complete all the lectures, video lectures, online video lectures, and if you are able to write all the tests and test series within that duration, then in such case, we are pretty much sure, like, you are able to crack any sort of competitive examinations. And the courses provided by an academy all are completely structured courses, right? So and the syllabus will be framed in such a way that it will fit the syllabus of latest GATE and ESE, right? So that you can crack any sort of competitive examination in future also. That is the third thing. And coming to the fourth advantage is, let us suppose one of your student is not able to access a lecture, not able to attend a lecture on live on one day. In such case, he will be provided with the same lecture in terms of recorded mode for n number of times he can watch, maybe through with the help of a cell phone, or maybe with the help of a tab, or maybe with the help of PC, depending on the mode of comfort of any of the devices. So these are the four advantages. All these four advantages will make you guys ready to crack any sort of competitive examinations in civil engineering or any other competitive examination in which you had subscribed for, right? Definitely. Some people will also say, like, sir, okay, these are some of the topmost indicators that you have. You can directly have an access directly in the app also. I just want to convey, these courses will be taught separately in English and also in Hindi. There won't be any language barrier also. If you are comfortable in English, you can attend English lectures. If you are comfortable in Hindi, you can attend Hindi lectures. Depending on your comfort, the courses are also framed, right? So there won't be any language barrier also, guys, right? I just want to convey, some people will also ask us, sir, till now in GATE and ESE, how many courses you people had launched? Especially in civil engineering, till now we people had launched 8 courses. As we people had launched 8 courses, out of these 8 courses, few courses are in English, few courses are in Hindi, few courses are long-term courses, few courses are short-term courses. When you had taken subscription, you will be provided access to all the courses that are running in that particular branch. Okay, so there won't be any problem. You will be provided with access to all the courses within that branch. And if you want to take subscription, you can use this referral code VD10 to get 10% discount directly on all the courses in Unacademy Plus in learning app. Okay, right. Coming to the financial terms, if it is a 12-month course, the cost is, 10% discount, the cost is 27,225. After if it is a 24-month course subscription, the cost after 10% discount is 39,600. So I can say like in any case, if you want to get 10% discount, you are bound to use this code VT10 to get 10% discount. Don't forget to use this code VT10. If you forget to use this code VT10, 10% higher amount you need to pay, right? And I just want to convey one more thing. You are able to follow me. Use this link which is given here. And you type this link, and when you press this link, it will redirect to my page. You can follow me by using this link which is given here, right? So, okay. I just want to say, every day my class is happening in this Let's Crack GATE, ESE and Civil YouTube channel. My class is happening by 11 a.m. every day for 2 hours, especially on other than on Sunday and Monday. Every day my class is existing. Okay, so before I start the actual session, I just want to convey, I already started Telegram group. So you can use this Telegram, you can, what the name of the Telegram channel is, Unacademy_CivilEngineerTilak. If you want to directly come down to my Telegram group directly, so in such case you can use the link which is given below. I hope you use the link which is given below. Use this link, Unacademy_Civil_Engineer_Tilak. C is capital here, D is capital, and T is capital. And if you press directly this link, it will redirect you guys to my Telegram group. And when you come down to Telegram group, if you had any doubts, you can post your doubts, one thing. And second thing is, when you have doubts other than structural engineering, you can post those doubts. The other faculty from non-structural background will be able to answer your queries directly in that group. Okay, nice. Right. Yeah. Let me start the session, bros. Before I start the session, let me take a pail of water. Okay. Okay. So the today's session is all about flanged beams, right? So what is the flanged beam? A beam which has got flanges and webs separately, those beams are nothing but flanged beams. Like example for a flanged beam, like I beam, L beam, T beam, all these are flanged beams. So I hope you know flanges in this one. So any beam which is having some flanges, those beams are called as flanged beams. So some people will say, like, sir, is the flange, where we can see this flanged beams? In all our basic building structures, we can see our flanged beams. But how we can frame these flanged beams in our regular building structures? People think, sir, the only way we are able to see the cross section of the beam is rectangle. Okay, but when in the construction itself, if the construction is a monolithic construction, like same joint, let us suppose this is a slab. Okay, let us suppose this is a slab, for example, and there are columns are there at the ends, and this is how the columns are there, and beams are running from one column to another column. This is one beam, and there is another beam here. These beams are resting on the columns, so I just want to show are the columns. Okay, this is another beam which is running in this way. So when you see these beams which are running between the columns, right, so this is in plan, I can see, right, one second, this is in plan, I can see. Okay, some people will say, like, sir, this is in plan, how you can say these are rectangular beams, how you can say these are flanged beams? Just when I show in sectional elevation, maybe if this is the cut section, maybe this cut section exits, for example, brother, then in such case the same, this is the slab. So to this slab here at the end, there is the rectangular beam is there. Okay, and here also you people think, like, it's a rectangular beam, and here there is a rectangular beam is here, and here there is a rectangular. You people think in this way, but when there is a when these beams and slabs, when the reinforcement of slab and beams are having the same joint here, I hope here this is the same joint here. Between the beams and column, there is the same joint. That means the reinforcement of the beam is kept in slab, and slab reinforcement is bent into beam. In such case, if I casted concrete, then in such case the beam, I hope you can say this beam and some portion of the slab and some portion of the slab will act together. So this is the beam and this is some portion of the slab. This beam and some portion of the slab will act together. Here also this is the beam and some portion of the slab will act together. When there is having when the reinforcement of this slab is bent into beam and the reinforcement of the beam is kept along with slab, and there is a common same joint in such case, you will see the behavior of this rectangular beam here is just like that of a flanged beam, and the shape of this beam is a T beam, right? And the shape of this beam is a T beam. Here also the shape of the behavior of the beam is a T beam. But here when you come down here, in association with the beam, with the rectangular beam, some portion of the slab will lag. So if you see what is the shape of the behavior of this rectangular beam, the rectangular beam will behave as a here clearly as an L beam here. So here also rectangular beam will behave as an L beam because of its monolithic constructions, I can say, right? So monolithic constructions are those constructions which are having same joint, and the reinforcement of one element is kept in another element, and there is concrete has got casted for those two elements at the same time. Such type of elements are nothing but such type of construction is nothing but monolithic construction. So in these cases, the beams, even though it's the beams are rectangular, but those beams behavior is just like that of a flanged beam. Okay. Some people will come and say, in which cases we can see the behavior of beams are just like flanged beams. I hope in case of precast construction. This is the slab, brother. Maybe I hope. This is a slab. This is slab and this is beam. Between slab and beam, here if I had gone for a shear connector or shear connection, shear connector, when they provided shear connectors, especially in a precast slab construction, precast construction, in precast construction should have shear connectors between the slab and the beam. So when there is a shear connector between slab and the beam, especially in case of precast construction, so along with this beam, some flange or some width of the slab, I can say some portion of the slab will act in association with this beam. This is the beam, some width of the slab, maybe from here to here. This much portion of the slab will act in association with this rectangular beam. So if you take the total shape of the slab, which will act together, is this T shape. So that's the reason why I can see flanged beams, even especially at the time of precast construction, having shear connectors will act as a flanged beam, definitely, right? So some people will also say like, sir, okay, can you show what are this, if you take a flanged beam, so what is the flange width, what is the depth of the flange, what are the notations generally we will use? Please excuse me. I'll be back in a minute. Sorry. I'll be back in a minute. Please excuse me. Sorry guys, sorry about the small disturbance which happened. Okay, yeah, let me move to the next slide. So some people will say like, sir, if you had taken this flanged beam, in this flanged beam, how you can say what is this? And I just want to say, especially in monolithic construction also, we can in monolithic constructions, the rectangular beams will behave as flanger beams. I already mentioned. This is an example. So here, this portion, these are columns. Column C1, maybe column C2. If this section is cut as XX, this is section I can write. In this section XX, in this section XX, the beams which are here and here, these beams are intermediate beams. Intermediate beams shapes are actually, shape of intermediate beams are T beams, right? Whereas these beams which are, these are end beams. These are end beams. End beams shape, when those are connected beams, end beam shapes are just like that of L beams. In I can say inverted L beam, right? So if you take this beam, if you take this beam, these are end beams. End beams are, I can say, L beams, I can say. End beams will have generally, if you take these end beams will have bending moment, shear force. In addition to bending moment and shear force, torsional moment is also dominant on this end beams. If you take these end beams, in addition to bending moment, I hope you know, these beams, if you take these end beams, generally, I can say, torsion is also dominant. Whereas if you take intermediate beams, because of vertically downward loads, I can say no torsion will develop. So some people will say, like, sir, how I will get torsion on these end beams? How I will not get no torsion on this intermediate beams? If you take this end beams, generally, brother, if you take this end beams, generally the load coming on a beam from this lab, we can work out from yield line theory, when this is how this load will get dispersed from each and every end corner. And this is how the loads will get dispersed, and this is how the load will get dispersed. If you take this end beam, on this end beam, the trapezium area of this slab load will come on this end beam. This trapezium area of the slab load will come on this end beam. So when you take this end beam, the load is only completely on one side of this end beam. If you take this end beam axis, this one, if you take end beam axis, this one, the load is completely acting on one side of the beam. So because of which, it will create a couple around the major axis of the beam. If you want to say about this axis, a moment is developed. This moment is actually called as this axis for the cross section of the beam. End beam is called polar axis. So the moment is acting about the polar axis of the cross section. So especially for end beams, in addition to normal bending moment and shear force, torsional moment is also dominant. So that's the reason why I had mentioned for end beams, shear force, bending moment and torsion. Whereas if you had taken these intermediate beams are shape is T beams. This doesn't have any sort of torsional bending moment. Some people will cry at me, why those beams doesn't have any sort of torsional moment. Here, if you can see, the load is on the left hand side and the slab is also there on the right hand side, right, in this way, right? So this much area of the slab load, even from the right hand side and even from the left hand side, are there. So two equal and opposite moments will get developed about the major axis of the cross section. One is clock, another one is anti-clock of same magnitude. So that the torsional moment will get nullified. So I can say no torsion is existing on intermediate beams. Only torsion is existing on end beams, right? And I can say, especially in connected beams, end beams are having a shape of L beam, L flanged beams. Intermediate beams are having a shape of a behavior of T beams. Both these L beams and T beams are flanged beams only. Is that okay, brother? Right? So I just want to convey, like, sir, How I can define flange width, depth of the flange. So I just want to show that if you take a T beam, for example, this is a T beam. In this T beam, brother, in this T beam, BF stands for width of the beam. I can say width of the beam or width of the flange width or flange width of beam. Width of the beam or flange width of the beam. What this DF stands for? DF stands for depth of the flange or thickness of the depth of the flange. This is depth of flange, or this depth of the flange is also called as here. It is nothing but thickness of the slab. Thickness of slab. So depth of the flange is depth of thickness of the slab or depth of flange, I can say. And BW, what is this width of so BF, effective BW stands for width of, sorry, one second brother. So what is this BW? This BW stands for width of the beam, or in other words, this BW is also called as width of web, right? What is this BF, BF stands for breadth of the flange or effective width of the flange. So this is BF, which is nothing but effective width of flange. And what about small d? The small d actually, sorry, this small d actually, what is this small d stands for? What this small d stands for here, brother? The small d, which is the effective depth, which is measured from extreme compression fiber to the centroid of the tension steel. This is tension steel from the to the centroid of tension steel. The distance is taken as the effective depth, which is d. So I can say d stands for effective depth. Effective depth of flanged beam. Like that we can write. Okay? Right. Some people will say, like, sir, you mentioned the terminology called as effective flange width. Nah? So how to connect, how to work out this effective flange width when these rectangular beams are cast monolithic with the slab? How to work out the effective flange width? That is the question. So I can say, like, effective flange width calculation. The effective flange width calculation when rectangular beams were cast monolithic construction with the slab. So monolithic construction means having same joint. In such case, I just want to say one thing, how you can say this effective flange width. So I can generally define this effective flange width. One second. I can define this effective flange width, which is called as BF. How it can be calculated? It is calculated based on empirical formula. So this formula that was given in IS 456 for effective flange width is empirical formula. So you can understand there is no proof for that. So based on experience, based on observation, such formula was developed. So there is no proof for that one because it is an empirical formula. Please understand that one. So maybe I can write for you empirical formula. Maybe doesn't have any proof. Any proof. Just based on experience was developed. Right. yeah, this empirical formula, whatever I will give right now, just within these 5 minutes, okay, that formula was given in IS 456-2000 code of practice. I can say by the time I am working out this effective flange width, the slab which is the slab which is under compression is only added to this flanges. The slab which is under tension will not be added to this flange width. So please understand that. So that the slab which is added to the beam should be in compression. There are two types of beams are there. One is by the time we are calculating effective flange width, there are two types of beams are possible. Maybe I can say the first type of beam is maybe in case of corrected beams. Second one are isolated beams. In both the cases, the effective flange width value, BF, whatever you call effective flange width calculation, BF will be of different empirical formulas. Right. So now coming to in case of this connected beam, in connected beams. So some people will say, sir, how you can say the beams are connected beams? Dear brother, I had shown you an example in the previous slide. This is how an example for connected beams are there. I hope, are you able to see this connected beams here? The sketch will let me erase the screen. So all these beams which are in this plan are connected beams because this is one beam. So if a slab is supported by more than one beam, those beams are connected beams category. Here, if you take this entire slab, maybe how many beams are there, brother? Beam 1, 2, 3, 4, and this slab is supported by 4 beams. This is the category of connected beams, right? Is that okay? Hi Sushil with civil IQ. Hi brother, how are you? Hope you are fine, right? Yeah. So this is an example for connected beams. Some people will come and ask us, sir, can you show an example for isolated beams? Yes, brother. There are two types of beams in this flanged beams. I can say one beam we can consider as connected beams. The another beams we can consider as isolated. How you can say how you can define isolated beams when this slab is supported by, okay, just a single beam. By just a single beam. In such case, such beams are nothing but isolated beams. Okay. Anyway, for this connected beams. In connected beams are also, there are the formula for breadth of the flange, effective width of the flange is different for end beams, is different for intermediate beams. Intermediate beams. Right. So example for what is the shape of this intermediate beam? Generally, the shape of this intermediate beam is a T beam. What is the shape of this end beam? Shape of this end beam is an L beam, inverted L beam or L beam. Okay. So coming to this T beam, if the beam is a T beam, which is nothing but an intermediate beam. In case of intermediate beams, especially in connected beams, how we can calculate the effective flange width? So the width of the slab which will act in association with the rectangular beam. So BF stands for, in other words, I can say is slab width which act in association with the rectangular beam. The rectangular beam, such beams are nothing, such width is nothing but BF, right? We call that BF as effective flange width also. So the definition of effective flange width indirectly I had given here. Effective flange width, the slab width which act in association with the rectangular beam, that slab width is nothing but effective flange width. Okay, now how you can work out this effective flange width? There is a formula, is there, L naught by 6 plus BW, breadth of the web, or breadth of web or beam, breadth of the web or beam, 6 times of the DF stands for depth of the flange, which is nothing but depth of slab, overall depth of the slab. DF stands for depth of the flange. Right. This I already teach you in your previous slide, depth of flange. Now I define this BW, I define this DF. I need to define two things, one is C and the other one is L naught. How I can define this C? So if I want to define this C here, right, what is C here? Can you see in this figure what is the C value? C is the spacing between two adjacent beams. Center to center distance of two adjacent beams is nothing but spacing C. So I can see, right, I can write C as spacing of beams between center to center, that is nothing but C. So I can say this is C, right? Okay, I already defined even C also, right? Here the C definition is also over, the spacing of the two adjacent beams in a slab beam construction, right? So I just need to define what is this L naught. So how can you define this L naught? L naught is the center to center distance between zero bending moments, or distance between points of two contraflexure indirectly. L naught is the center, maybe let me rub here. Yes. How you can define this L naught? Center to center distance between zero bending moment points, or points of contraflexure also. So L naught stands for indirectly effective length. What is the effective length of the beam? So how can you do this one? See, if you see this figure, brother, you see this figure. If I erase this one, the actual length of the beam is L is equal to the actual length of the beam. This is the length of the beam which is supporting. This is between column C1 and between column C2. The actual length of the beam is L. L is actual length of beam. What is L naught stands for? L naught stands for, I can say L naught stands for distance between center to center distance between zero bending moment points. Center to center distance between zero bending moment point. So how can you say this L naught, which is the center to center distance between zero bending moment points? Here there is column, here there is column. Let us suppose there are two things. When the beam is supported, when the beam is resting on the columns as simple supported, in such case the effective length has having one value. When this beam is resting on columns as if it is a continuous beam or a fixed beam, in such case this effective length L naught is of different value. I just want to show you that, guys. Okay, so let us suppose this is a beam, this is the, you can take this reactions are columns here, columns. The beam is resting on a column in terms of simple supported beam. In terms of simple supported beam, the ends allows rotation. So here this is a it is a zero bending moment point is here, and there is a zero bending moment point is here. So L. So if you take this L naught, what is this L naught? Here it is 1 times of L. So 1 times of L is nothing but L naught. When the beam resting on the columns is just like that of a simply supported beam, right? So some people will say, like, sir, let us suppose this is the beam, sir. The beam is resting on column as if as if the beam is continuous or fixed. This beam, 1 second. I hope this beam is resting on columns. I hope you can take this column. Okay, as if the beam is resting on the column, as if the beam is a fixed beam or a continuous beam. When the beam is fixed beam or a continuous beam, you can treat it as a fixed one. In such case, this is how the deformation sketch is possible. Now, this is the point of contraflexure, where the bending moment is changing its sign, or zero bending moment. This is the point of contraflexure, where the bending moment is changing its sign. So, simply I can say, this is how maybe the bending moment is there when it is acting with the help of a point. So I can say this is point of contraflexure and this is the point of contraflexure. Now in this case, what is the distance between points of contraflexure, which we people call it as L naught. The distance between points of two contraflexure is L naught, which is taken as out of total length L. Total length is L. Out of total length L, this length, which is the distance between points of contraflexure, is roughly around 70% of the total length, which is L naught is 0.7 times of L. Right? Okay. Some people will say like, sir, okay, especially in the case of In the case of this fixed or continuous beam, I hope you can see this slab which has got bent in this way. This slab is under tension zone. This is tension zone of the slab. Only the slab which is under compression zone, that much width is only added to the slab width which is under compression. That much slab width is only added as the effective flange width, right? So I can say in case of this type of beams here are, I can say this is a continuous beam. If slab on either side of the beam, to take a beam, the slab on either side of the beam is in compression. Then only it can be added as a flange to the beam. Slab which is under tension zone slab of the beam cannot be added as the flange width. I just want to convey that, right? Some people will say like, okay sir, if this is the flange width is BF and here this flange width is BF, right? So first of all, you tell me, you had already given the flange width, effective flange width for T beam you had given. What is the effective flange width for T beam in case of, connected beams, effective flange width for T beam, how it was mentioned. So can you people tell me about that? So I had already given an empirical rule for that one. So which is BF is L naught by 6 plus the breadth of the web plus 6 times of depth of the flange. This value should not be greater than spacing between the two adjacent beams. This is a one beam. This is the another beam. The spacing between it should not be greater than the spacing between two adjacent beams. This is the effective flange width for T beams in case of connected beams. So in addition to a T beam, there is a chance like the end, this is intermediate beam. We had written the effective flange width for intermediate beam in case of connected beam. What is the effective flange width in case of this beam is nothing but end beam. End beam, or I can say L beam. I just want to write. I just want to write effective flange width for this. Okay. For this end beam. 1 second. So how you can write the BF flange width for end beam or L beam? For L beam or end beam in connected beams criteria or in isolated beam criteria? In connected beam criteria, because what is a connected beam? Connected beams are those beams in which if there are more than one beam is there supporting the slab, such type of beams distribution we can call it as connected beam distribution. Okay, so for this one, can you tell me how to work out this effective flange width, brother? So what is the difference between this L type of end beam and T type of intermediate beam? So when you take this intermediate beam, the intermediate beam has got flange width even on another side of this rectangular beam. On the left hand side of this rectangular beam also some width is there. So indirectly I can write here this flange width for L beam is flange width of T beam by 2 indirectly. What is the flange width of T beam? This value. So I can write directly this value, but BW is BW. So I can write L0 by 12 plus BW plus I can write 3 times of depth of the flange. I can write 3 times of depth of the flange. This value should not be greater than C by 2. Here it is C na. So but for L beam, when compared to T beam and L beam flange width is T beam flange width divided by 2 except at BW. So I can say it should not be greater than C by 2. This is how you can write. Now everybody will also ask us, sir, where we can see this L beams, right? Everybody will also ask. So I just want to show where we can see this inverted flanged beams. Okay, inverted flanged beams. So maybe where we can see this is an inverted flanged beam. Generally flanged beam is this is how a flanged beam is there, na? L beam is a flanged beam. What is this beam? This beam is nothing but inverted flanged beam. Where we can see this inverted flanged beams? Inverted flanged beams are used in inverted flanged beams are used in cantilever porches. I hope you can see this is a cantilever. This is a cantilever slab is there in this way. To support this cantilever slab, let the beams, the rectangular beams were kept on the top side of the top side of the beam. In this top side of the beam, right? Now why some people will say like, sir, why only at the top side? For cantilever, brothers, let us suppose if you take a cantilever in this way, the tension is on the top side, the compression is on the bottom side, the flange width of the slab will be added to the width of the rectangular beam when it is only on compression side, to get slab on the compression side, especially for this cantilever beam. I just want to write for cantilever slab tension zone is on top and compression zone is on bottom. To have effective flange width, the slab portion should be under compression. So when in this case of this what is the name of this slab for this cantilever slab, if you take for this cantilever slab, on what side the slab should be there so that it will show the effect of this flange beam. If the same slab is on the top side, the entire slab is under tension, so in such case the beam behavior is just like that of rectangular beam. In order to avoid that type of stuff, generally, especially in this inverted, especially in cantilever portions, especially like example for this one is portico. I hope you know, you might had seen example for this, sir, portico or porches. In case of porticos or porches, generally for the slabs, the beams are running at the top side of the slab, whereas the slab is on the bottom side. Just why the basic thing is just the always the slab should always be on the compression side. So to increase the effective flange width as per IS-456, just to satisfy that effect, okay, to have to make the effect of a rectangular beam as a flanged beam, the slab should be kept here in this particular case of porticos or porches on the bottom side. In this case, what is the type of flanged beams I will get? The type of flanged beams that I will get are inverted flanged beams. I hope the slab is on the bottom, so you are able to see. The beams that we are getting are definitely the inverted flanged beams, right? Inverted flanged beams. Okay. One second. So, example for this cantilever slab with inverted flanged beams are porticos and porches. The reason also I had mentioned clearly, right, is how we can work out the effective flange width for connected beams, for end beams separately and for intermediate beams separately, right? This is what the effective flange width is, L0 by 12 plus breadth of the, this is for L beams, okay, which is for end beams. L beams in sense for end beams, maybe inverted L beam or maybe L beam, anything. For both the cases, effective flange width is L0 by 12 plus BW plus 3 times of DF, should not be greater than C by 2. And this formula is actually an empirical formula. Don't expect any sort of proof for this formula, because it is an empirical formula. By experience, it was given. Okay. Now, everybody, most of my brothers will ask us, sir, you mentioned the effective flange width equation for end beams and for intermediate beams. Okay. End beams we can call as, end beam shape is L beam shape. End beams behavior is L beam or inverted L beam. L beam or I can say inverted L beam. Maybe if you take intermediate beams, either the beam can be a T beam or inverted T beam. Sunil Dodia. राइट सर, आप तो ग्रेड अप पर पढ़ा रहे थे. हाँ, प्रीवियसली आई वर्क फॉर ग्रेड अप ऑल्सो. Yes, brother Suril Dodier. Yes, previously I taught for GRID, RG. Right. So, if you please excuse me, I had given the empirical formulas for effective flange widths in case of connected beams. Other students will ask us, sir, please give us the empirical formulas, especially in case of isolated beams also. Yes, I want to give for that. Is that okay? So, in case of isolated beams, what is an example for what? How you can define an isolated beam? If a single beam is supporting the entire slab, okay. Such type of beams are nothing but isolated beams. If a single beam is supporting slab, then such beams are isolated beams. Right. Now, how we can mention about this isolated beam? I hope the sketch is directly given here. I hope this is the sketch. This is a single slab. I hope you can say this is the entirely single slab. This single slab is supported by a single beam. This is a beam. Maybe this may be B1, which is running between column 1, C1 and column 2, C2. If a single beam is supporting, a single beam is supporting the slab. Right now you can understand this portion of this slab is under compression. This portion of the slab is under compression. So I can say this is the effective flange width of the slab. Right. How I can work out this effective flange width of the slab? Some people had a doubt like how this can be under compression, because the bending for beam, because for the bending for beam, even though the slab will bend in the slab will span here. Okay. If you take the slab will span in second. The slab will span. Change the color. The slab is spanning in this direction and the slab is spanning in this direction. But if you take the beam is spanning in this direction. So if the beam is spanning in this direction, the top level of the beam is under compression, bottom level of the beam is under tension, because it may be something like some simple supported beam on both the columns, or maybe continuous beam on both the columns. Okay. Now, if you take some portion here as it will bend in this direction, the beam is bending in this direction here. So definitely, I can say some portion of the slab is in compression. Thus, the width of the slab which is under compression, we can consider as a flange width of the slab, right? So how you can work out the flange width of the slab, brother? The flange width of the slab, BF, which we call it as BF. How you can write that BF as? BF is, if this is, if this length, the space, if L is equal to span. L is equal to span of the beam. If L is equal to span of the beam, okay. Yeah, and what is L naught? It is the center to center distance between zero bending moment point. Generally, I can say for continuous beam, this L naught is less than L. So I can say L naught is equal to 0.7 times of L for fixed or continuous beams. Whereas L naught is equal to, I can write as 1 times of L for simply supported beams. Okay, coming to this effective width BF, this is also an empirical formula. Please understand, there is no proof if you refer anywhere, because it is an empirical formula. So if B is the actual flange width available, so what is the actual flange width of the slab available? The actual flange width of the slab available is B. If B is the actual flange width of the slab available, now what is the effective flange width of the slab? The flange width of the slab which is under compression, which acts in association with the rectangular beam. I can say that value of BF is equal to L naught, which is center to center distance between zero bending moment point, which is L naught by B plus 4 plus BW, right? So B stands for actual width of the flange. So B stands for actual width of flange width, or actual width of slab available. Actual width of slab available. Example for this case, some people will say, like, sir, have you seen any case? Is there any bridge or is there any slab? Is there in which the slab is supported by one beam? In such case, the example I can say, it is simply supported. T beam bridge is an example for that, right? So I hope you can say this is a simply supported T beam bridge is an example for this isolated T beam. Okay. Right. And I just want to convey this effective width BF should not be greater than the actual width of the slab. Actual width of the slab is B. Right. So some people will say, like, sir, you had mentioned in isolated beams the effective flange width for beams. Yeah, the effective flange width for I can say T beam you mentioned. What is the effective flange width for L beams in case of isolated beams? In case of isolated beams, how you can do this one? So I hope you can say, like, what is the difference between a full T beam? One second. Let me erase this. What is the difference between flange width? Let me show here. This is the flange width of a T beam. Okay. This we call it as BF. What is the flange width of an L section or inverted L? So here I can say, if I use this color, this is the flange width of an inverted L, but this one is extra. This one I need to remove, and this width is actually BW, right? So I can say, what is this width? This width is already this width question mark plus question mark. So I can write this total flange width is L naught by B plus 4 plus breadth of the web. This is how we can mention. Now, after this, if I want to get only this is breadth of the web, this is question mark value. How you can write that question mark value? Previously, this is the two question marks value is L naught by B plus 4. So coming to the single question mark value, half of this width. So I can say, in case of L beam, especially in isolated beams, this breadth of the flange is L naught by B plus 4 multiplied by 0.5. There is 0.5 multiplied plus BW. And here you should understand, here also the breadth of the flange should not be greater than the actual width of the slab. What is the actual width of the slab? Maybe I can say this is the actual width of the slab. This may be the actual width of this B. Actual width of slab. Now, especially where some people will say, like, sir, where you could see this L beam in case of isolated beams? I could see this L beam in case of isolated beams, just like the example is in case of portico, sunshade, or sajas. In case of portico or sunshade or sajas, this is the beam, for example, if this is a beam, okay, if this is a beam, in case of porticos or sunshade or shajas, if you can see, this is how the slab is spanning, whereas the beam is spanning in this direction, right? So here I can say this is the breadth of the flange is BF. Breadth of the flange BF is 0.5 times of L0 by B plus 4 plus BW, right? So we completed, I think like we completed the theory on the effective flange width. Let us work out few problems on effective flange width, and after that we will move to the analysis, how to work out the actual depth of nodal axis for a flanged beam, how to work out the moment of resistance of a flanged beam, that we will work out in the analysis of flanged beam, right? So can you see this question? A footbridge has a slab width of, the slab width of the footbridge is, actual slab width of the footbridge is 3 meter. So B is 3 meter. The central supporting beam, is of 6 meter length. Okay, that is L is equal to 6 meter. Width of the web, I can say width of the web is 0.250 millimeter, na? So 250 millimeter, I can say it is 0.25 meter, right? And I can say they are saying the footbridge, the central supporting beam, there is only one beam is there, and that single beam is supporting at the center. Maybe I can show, this is how the sketch is. The actual width of the slab is 3 meter. Actual width of the slab is 3 meter. Okay, and this is how a central, the central supporting beam at the center, a supporting, a beam is supporting that slab in this way, and the length of that beam is how much, man? It is 6 meter. Okay, and the width of the web is 250 millimeter. So I can write this is 250 millimeter, now which is 0.25 meter, right? In this way. Now, for this one, what they are saying, the effective flange width. Now you tell me, just only one beam is there. One beam is supporting this slab. When only one beam is supporting this slab, it is a question of isolated T beam. So I can say it is an isolated, and the slab and the beam is at the mid, na? So you can say that it is an isolated T beam. In isolated T beam or isolated beam with the intermediate beam, I can say. How you can say the effective flange width BF, man? How you can say the effective flange width BF? Effective flange width BF is equal to, I can write L0 by B plus 4 plus BW. This is how we can write. So coming to L0, what is this L0, brother? It is the center to center distance between zero bending moment points, or distance between points of two contraflexure. And they are saying a foot bridge has a slab. And what is the nature of that beam is, if nothing was mentioned, na, isolated T beam, and it is an isolated T beam is generally simple supported beam generally, right? Isolated T beam is generally simple supported. So in such case, this L0 I can treat as L0 is equal to L, and the value of L is 6 meter. Right? So can I work out right now the effective width, please? So coming to this effective flange width, L0 is 6 meter by, L0 6 meter by actual width of the slab, which is B. What is the actual width of the slab, which is 3 meter divided by 3? I can write plus 4 plus breadth of the web. This is 6 meter, this is 6 meter by 3 meter, plus this breadth of the web must and should also be mentioned in terms of meters. Because everything, the length I had substituted in terms of meters. Now, let me write everything in terms of meters. So, plus BW. But BW is 0.25 meter. So, if you get if you get the overall breadth of the flange, the overall breadth of the flange is 1.25 meter and this value is less than actual width of the slab. PF is actual flange width. BFP is not the actual flange width, I can say. BF is effective flange width, I can say. BF is effective flange. So, and the effective flange width BF is equal to 1.25 meter. And this value of this BF should always be less than B. And what is the actual width of this slab? Should be less than 3 meters. Yes, so the answer is 1.25. You can keep B, option B is the correct one. Is that okay? Right. Shall I move to the next question, brother? Right. Can I move to the next question? One second, let me drink some pail of water and after that I will move to the next question. I hope you are able to see a question. These questions actually were asked in ESC and GATE also about the effective flange width. Just you need to substitute the proper formula for effective flange width, one thing, right? And you need to substitute the proper formula for effective flange width. You need to understand whether the system of beams are connected system of beams or isolated system of beams. In connected system of beams, whether it is an intermediate beam or whether it is an end beam, you are able to judge these four. Then working out that problem is easy, brother. Shubham Sachan, sir, one time repeat. Yes, definitely, brother. I will repeat that one time. 12.16, right? Yeah. So, dear brother, can you see this one? This is just a substitution of formula. What the question is asking, they are expecting the question is effective flange width of the slab. How you can find out the effective flange width of the slab in case of an isolated beam? Because there is only one beam, one central beam is supporting the slab. So what is the type of beam? The type of beam is isolated beam. And the beam is exactly at the central level. And the beam is exactly at the central level. This is an intermediate beam. Intermediate beam. Or intermediate beam or T beam. I can say totally this is an isolated T beam, isolated intermediate T beam, I can say. And as the support conditions of the beam are not mentioned, so generally a footover bridge is supported on the columns definitely by using a simple supported condition. So that's the reason why practically I can say like this isolated T beam is simply supported. Maybe if you want, I can show clearly this is a simply supported beam at this end. So for that one, what is the effective flange width for isolated T beam? It is L naught by B plus 4. What is this actual B stands for? B stands for the actual width of the slab. What is the actual width of the slab, brother? The actual width of the slab, which is B. The actual width of the slab from this point to this point, which is B, which is 3 meter. The actual width of the slab is 3 meter. And coming to L naught. L naught, how you can define L naught? It is the center to center. Maybe if you please allow me, what is L naught here? This is in cross section. Okay, the same thing. If I had shown in top view, maybe let me change. Let me rub the screen here. So maybe let me one second. Just see. Erase. So here I am just erasing all this stuff. This is the final formula, right? This is the final formula. If you are able to understand about the parameters, the problem is over. Now the question is, everybody will ask us, what is L naught? So what is the basic definition for L naught? L naught is the center to center distance between points of zero bending moments. So if you want to see the same thing, this is how a beam is resting. This is how a beam is resting in this way. The actual length of the beam from these two supports is L. What is this beam? Is simple supported. For simple supported beam, here at this point the bending moment is zero. At this point the bending moment is zero. L naught, which is the center to center distance between center to center distance between zero bending moment points, as it is center to center distance between zero bending moment points, I can say in case of simple supported beam, this is one zero bending moment point, this is another bending zero bending moment point. So L naught is one times of L. When it is a fixed beam or a continuous beam, its L naught, center to center distance between zero bending moment point, is 0.7 times of L. Here it is not required. So directly if you substitute this B of is L naught. L naught is 1 times of L. L is how much, brother? The length of the supporting beam is of length 6 meter. So I can say 6 meter by B stands for the actual width of the slab. What is the actual width of the slab? The actual width of the slab is 3 meter divided by 3 meter plus 4 plus BW. I mentioned every dimension in terms of meters. So BW value must and should be mentioned in terms of meters. So what is the value of BW? The width of the web in meters. The width of the web in meters is 0.25 meter. This is the width of the web. This is 0.25 meter. I can write plus 0.25. If you work out this one, brother, definitely you will end up with 1.25, right? 1.25 meters, because I substitute everything in meters na? So the value of this BF is effective flange width is 1.25 meter, and this value should be less than the actual width of the slab. The actual width of the slab is how much? It is 3 meters. So it is less than B. So finally I can come to a conclusion, the actual width of the effective flange width is 1.25 meter. Okay, right. Yes, right. Can you see this question, dear Shubham Sachan? Shubham Sachan bro, can you see this question? Right. Yes, I hope you are able to see this question, dear Shubham Sachan bro. A hall of 10 meter by 15 meter consists of A hall of 10 meter by 15 meter consists of a number of beams 3 meter center to center parallel to shorter span of the hall. So maybe I can draw, one is 10 meter and one is 15 meter. This is 10 meter and this is 15 meter I had drawn in this. How the beams are running consists of a number of 3 beams, number of beams 3 meter center to center, 3 beams center to center parallel to the shorter span. So that is the spacing between the beams is 3 meter. 3 meter center to center spacing, and this spanning of these beams are happening parallel to the shorter span. So if you take, this is a beam, this is 10 meter. And this is 15 meter. Okay. Now you tell me here. You tell me this is 10 meter. Beams are running parallel to the shorter span. This is the shorter span. The distance between the center to center distance between the beams is how much, brother? It is 3 meter. Na? So maybe out of 15 meters, here this is 1. This is spacing, I can say. This is 3 meter. So how many such beams I can space? I can space here. This is 3 meter. This is 3 meter. This is 3 meter, and this is 3 meter. So totally, how many beams I had kept? Maybe I can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I am able to keep 6 beams. Now all the 6 beams are running. Two votes are along shorter direction. This 10 meter is shorter direction. Na? In this direction, the beam is running. In this direction, the beam is running. Beam is running along shorter. Width of the web. So the width of the web, we can write that width of the web, which is BW, is the width of the web, which is 250 millimeter. We can write it as 0.25 meter. Thickness of this slab. What is the thickness of this slab, brother? 1 second. The thickness of this slab, which is called as depth of the flange, which is nothing but thickness of the slab, is 100 millimeter, which is 0.1 meter. The beams are cast monolithic with the columns at the ends. So here the beams are spanning and these are resting on the columns. Let me show. This is a column and this is a column. How the conditions of support between the beams and columns? Between beams and columns, the joints are monolithic. The joints are monolithic. These beams are taken as fixed or continuous beams. When beams are taken as fixed or continuous beams, L naught is equal to 0.7 times of L. 0.7 times of what is the length of single beam? Length of single beam is running along shorter span, which is 10 meters. Is that it or not, brother? This is the shorter span, right? It is along the shorter span, the span is 10 meters. So the actual length of the beam along shorter span is 10 meters. No? So I can say this is 7 meter. Okay. The effective flange width of an intermediate beam. Now out of these 6 beams, 1 and 6 are end beams. End beams. When the end, I can say the type of beam are a L beam, an inverted L beam, I can say. But whereas if you take 2, 3, 4, 5 beams are intermediate beams. Beams are intermediate beam. They are expecting the effective flange width of an intermediate beam, and the system of beams are connected beams here because the slab is supported by 6 beams. So it is a connected system. So I can say, come to a conclusion, it's a connected beam system with intermediate beam. With intermediate beam, flange width required, right? Effective flange width required. Intermediate beam, effective flange width is required. So how can you work out that intermediate beam effective flange width? So can I write that equation, brother? You please excuse me. Can I rub the screen? Maybe I will rub this board here and I will write that here itself. I am writing this explanation here. So I just want to write the direct formula. When it is an intermediate beam with connected beam system, what is the effective flange width equation that you had seen? The effective flange width equation, BF is equal to L0 by 6 plus BW plus 6 times of depth of the flange. This value should not be greater than the actual width of the slab, right? This value should not be greater than the actual width of this. This should not be greater than the spacing of the beams. What is the spacing of the beams? Should not be greater than C, right? So which is L naught. L naught is how much, man? 7 by 6 plus effective width of the planes, BW, it is 0.25. six times of depth of the flange. Depth of the flange is 0.1, should not be greater than this is spacing of this one, which is C. Spacing of the beams is C and it should not be greater than 3 meters. So if you work out this one, this effective flange width is 2.016 meter, we can mention. So I can say 2.016. So the nearest answer is 2.01. You can write. So answer is option C, we can pick. Is that okay? Yeah. Shivam Sachin. Yes, 2.01 is the correct answer. So can I move to the next question? Because these questions were already asked in Yates and ESE. Okay, so those problems we are working out, because you should memorize this empirical formula. Right. And moving to the next question. In this next question, in the above problem is the statement is one and same. This is one and same. Here this is one and same. Okay. Whatever I can say, the data is same as that of previous question. Same data I can say. Okay. In the above problem, the beams are simply supported at the ends. The beams are simply supported, I can say, when beams are simply supported at the ends, L naught is equal to 1 times of L. This you know from the fundamentals. 1 times of L. 1 times of L stands for is 10 meter. So it is 10 meter. At the effective flange width of end beam, they are expecting effective flange width of end beam. Or end beam, or I can say L beam, or inverted L beam, whatever that may be. So how you can work out this one? So this is BW. So what is the relationship between end beam effective flange width and intermediate effective flange width? Intermediate effective flange width divided by 2. For intermediate effective flange width, it is L naught by 6. Right now, L naught by 6 by 2, which is L naught by 12. So for intermediate flange width, it is 6 times of depth of the flange. So it is 6 times of depth of the flange by 2. So it is 3 times of depth of the flange. This is how we can work out. And this value should not be greater than C by 2. What is this breadth of the web? So I hope you know the breadth of the web is from your previous question. The breadth of the web, breadth of the beam is 0.25 meter. And depth of the flange or depth of slab is how much from your previous problem. The above problem instance in the previous problem, I hope same data I had written here clearly. What is the depth of the flange? It is clearly 100 millimeter. So in terms of meter, it is 0.1 meter. Shall I write that one? So can I write here depth of the flange as 0.1 meter? Just try to substitute in this equation. Breadth of the web is 0.25 plus L naught by 2. What is that L naught? It is 10 by 12 plus 3 times of depth of the flange. What is that 3 times of depth of the flange, brother? Depth of the flange is 0.1. This is how you can work out, and it is this should not be greater than C by 2. C is 3 meter by 2. It should not be greater than 1.5 meter. But if you work out this answer is 1.38 meter. So this is how you can work out the effective width of the end beam. You can work out, right? Yes, right. Shubham Sachin, yeah. Okay. For today, if you please excuse me, for today I'm not feeling well, so I'm just interested to stop the session for today itself, for this time, which is 1.5 hours. So for in tomorrow session, I will take like 4 hours. Okay, so to complete the session. Okay, tomorrow the session is more. Actually, today I thought like I can do more, but I feel like some drowsy. But so please excuse me for today. Tomorrow I will talk more. Like I will work out more. Right? Yeah. Right. Yeah. Thank you very much. So before I conclude this one, we completed the effective width of the flanges. In the tomorrow session, we will talk about in the flanged beams, the analysis of T beams, analysis of L beams, we will talk. that one we will move to limit state of shear. Okay, right. Tomorrow's two parts we will tackle. Okay, 4 hours we will tackle. So before I end up the session, I just want to convey, like, if you are interested to join any sort of paid course, the cost for 12 months course is 27,225. Okay, after 10% discount, you will get 10% discount when you use this code VT10. One thing. If you want to join for 24 months subscription, after 10% discount, the cost is 39,600. Right. So these are the two things I can say. And you can join even for 1 month subscription or for 3 month subscription, but 6 month subscription. But at least 12 from if you are taking from 12 month subscription, that is more feasible, I feel. So that's the reason why I recommend either 12. I can recommend this 12 month course for the students who are in fourth year. If you people are in third year or second year, I can recommend you this 24 months course. Third year or second year, if you are in, I can recommend this 24 months course. So for any of the courses, don't forget to use this code VT10 to get 10% discount on Academy Plus. I just want to convey, every day my class is happening by 11 a.m. Every day my class is happening by 11 a.m. In this GATE 2021 rankers batch, my class is happening by 11 a.m. You can don't miss that one. If you don't want to miss my classes, then subscribe to this Let's Crack GATE and ESC Civil YouTube channel. You will not miss even single class that is coming in that channel. I just want to convey one more thing. You are getting all this for free of cost, na? So please share these videos to your friends also. So that they will also get benefited. One thing. And if you don't want to miss even a single class from this channel, which is for free in YouTube, right? Some topics we will read. Doesn't mean like we will teach everything in the YouTube. No. Like 30% we will teach in YouTube in detail. No problem, in detail. Whatever the maybe the topics that we will start, we will tackle those topics in detail. Okay. So if you want to listen to those topics, if you don't want to miss such lectures, in such case, press the bell icon also after you had subscribed to this Let's Crack GATE and ESC Civil YouTube channel. And if you want to take a paid course in an Academy Plus platform, use this code VT10 to get 10% discount on any courses in an Academy Plus, right? So and the name of the channel that you can we already started a Telegram group also. The name of the Telegram channel is Anacademy_Civil Engineer Tilak. If you come down to this Telegram group, this is my personalized Telegram group. You can come down to this Telegram group. You can post your doubts. I will take care of your doubts, brother. And this is the link if you want to join my Telegram group. And this is An Academy U Capital, Civil Engineer C Capital, Engineer E Capital, T Capital in here in Tilak. Okay, and there are underscores here also there. So please be aware. If you press this link, it will redirect you guys to my page. When you guys are in my page, in my group, you are able to ask any doubt. So you can post your doubts there. Okay. Sir, is there any class for SSC JE Mains? Shubham Sachar. Yes, brother, I just want to convey. Yes, definitely we will take even the classes for SSC JE Mains also. I just want to convey, for steel structures, I had tackled even the classes for SSC JE Mains also. In detail, I worked out for plate cutter and gantry cutter, brother. Dear Shubham Sachar. For steel structures, I worked out for plate gutter, gantry gutter, beams, even the conventional practice questions also I worked out. So you can come, if you are able to come down to our app. I teach the gantry gutter in the app. You can come down there in the app and you can see all these lectures that are done by me, which is the same as for SSC JEE mains also. Okay, right.